I'm Shirley Howard from Oregon Public Broadcasting, and with me is Dick Weinman, head of the Division of Broadcast Media Communication at Oregon State University.
And Shirley, according to tradition, the procession of degree candidates into Gill Coliseum has begun, as we can see. It's led by Chief Marshal Roger Fendall, a professor and head advisor for crop science in the College of Agricultural Sciences. About an hour ago, the members of the graduating class, 1992, began to gather on the quadrangle in front of the Memorial Union building.
The Oregon State University faculty and many of the students who will receive degrees today are beginning to fill the floor of area of Gill Coliseum. They are in alphabetical order according to the college in which they are getting their degree.
Those who will join Oregon State University President John Byrne on the platform today are his guests, including Mark Dotson, representing the Oregon State Board of Higher Education, the Honorary Degree and Distinguished Service Award recipients, and the Student Body President, Todd Mickey. Also in the platform party are the commandants of the four branches of the Reserve Officer Training Program, Colonel James Swinyard of the Air Force, Lieutenant Colonel Stephen Smith of the Army, Captain Robert Curtis of the Navy, and Lieutenant Colonel Barney Grimes of the Marine Corps. Other members of the platform party include the university's vice presidents, Roy G. Arnold, provost and vice president for academic affairs, L. Edwin Coate, vice president for finance and administration, Joanne Tro, vice president for student affairs, George Keller, vice president for research and graduate studies, and Lynn Spruill, vice president for university relations. The deans of Oregon State's colleges make up the rest of the platform party.
Not all of the 3,967 degree candidates will be in attendance this afternoon. Some completed their work at the end of a previous quarter and have left the campus last August, December, or March, and others have chosen not to participate. 2,005 are actually participating in this ceremony, and each will walk up the ramp one by one to receive his or her own diploma from the hand of their dean.
In the background, filling all the 10,500 seats in Gill Coliseum, you'll see parents, brothers, sisters, grandparents, spouses, and children, as well as friends. In the background, too, you'll hear the cheering sections rooting for their individuals' accomplishments. This is the eighth commencement at which Dr. John Byrne has presided. He arrived in the fall of 1984 and was officially inaugurated as president on March 10, 1985. This graduating class, now filing into their places in Gill Coliseum, leaves Oregon State University as the university poises on the brink of change. The coordination, reduction, and elimination of academic programs, departments, and even colleges, and a diminution of administrative and support services. The changes were proposed by President John Byrne to reduce the university budget by 20%. These proposals will be presented to the State Board of Higher Education later this month. They've been brought about as a consequence of the implementation of Ballot Measure 5. Already, some academic programs have been closed, journalism and broadcast media, for example. And some departments have been restructured into different administrative units, notably departments within the College of Education. The proposals, just announced the Monday prior to today's graduation, include the closure of the academic programs of the College of Veterinary Medicine. 440 positions have been proposed for elimination. Engineering and pharmacy students would pay a higher tuition than other students, whose tuition would also increase by about 15%. Finally, President Byrne's proposals for cutting $23 million from the OSU budget include reorganizing the upper administrative structure and reducing administrative and support services and administrative processes. Of course, This graduating class, marching into Gill Coliseum now, will be long gone from campus when the State Board of Higher Education acts upon President Byrne's proposals for the future of OSU, and when, and if, the board, the legislature, and the governor concur.
The changes in the College of Education began with the first budget cuts caused by Measure 5. And through this past year, plans have been made to merge the colleges of education and home economics. The reorganization of the College of Education means the program offerings will all be at the graduate level. The fifth-year professional teacher education program will lead to a Master of Arts in Teaching in Early Childhood Elementary Education and 8 secondary areas. Other degrees are a Master of Education degree with a major in education or in adult education, and a Master of Science degree with a major in counseling or college student services administration. The emphasis can be in such areas as community college leadership, middle schools, developmental education, and youth at risk. Dr. Wayne Haverson says the fifth-year concept is designed to encourage the best students to seek entry into a professional school in education, and they will bring a strong basic knowledge in their specializations obtained while earning a bachelor's degree. The result, he says, is higher admission standards and fewer graduate students. Today, the last students to graduate from the College of Education will follow the College of Home Economics through the academic procession. They will be wearing light blue tassels on their mortarboard. Their college was formed as the School of Vocational Education in 1918 with E.D. Ressler as its dean. And handing out these last diplomas to this class of undergraduates is Dr. Wayne Haverson, the acting dean. Dr. Haverson has a doctorate of education from the University of North Carolina.
The academic gowns being worn today represent a tradition which comes down from the universities of the Middle Ages. At that time, they were a common form of dress and were retained by the clergy when the laity adopted more modern styles. The cap, originally round, later became square mortarboards. The hoods attached to the gown were originally cowls, which could be slipped over the head for protection from the weather. The significance of the costume is indicated especially by the sleeves and the length of the hoods. The bachelor's gown has pointed sleeves. The master's gown has long, closed sleeves. The doctor's gown has bell-shaped sleeves and velvet trimmings. The colored velvet border of the hood indicates the field of study to which the degree pertains, as do the tassels on the mortarboards. The colorful lining of the hood indicates the institution from which the wearer received his or her degree. The lining of the Harvard University hood, for example, is crimson. At Yale, it's blue. And at Oregon State University, it's burnt orange.
And today, that color burnt orange is carried through in the flowers that we see used here in Gill Coliseum. They are orange gladioli obtained from the Chouinard Nursery and florist in Philomath. Both Chris and Lynette Chouinard are also alumni of Oregon State University. The arrangements were created by Anita Green, the undergraduate advisor at the Department of Horticulture. Oregon State University, with its undergraduate class being cheered into Gill Coliseum, has many unique, this commencement program has many unique aspects, but one is missing today. It's the bouquets of the majestic Aramuri. For the first time in the 43-year commencement ceremony history at Oregon State University, held here in Gill Coliseum, the Aramuri bloomed in April and this year were not available. They were chosen because the 5 to 6 foot stalks could be seen from every corner of Gill Coliseum. The usual flowers were first grown by Fred and Teresa Stone. Oregon State alumni A.J. and Glenna Walker Stone have carried on that tradition until this year. And even though the Aramuri aren't present today, Oregon State University does extend a very special thank you to the Stone family for the gracious donation of their time and the beautiful flowers over the years.
Oregon State University seniors graduating with honors are wearing colorful handmade cords on the left shoulder of their commencement gowns. These indicate that the student is graduating with academic honors. If the cords are burnt orange, Oregon State University's color, the student has earned a grade point average of 3.5 to 3.69, and the diplomas will identify a cum laude degree. If the cords are gold, the grade point average is 3.7 to 3.84. The diploma will indicate a magna cum laude degree. And if the cords are white, the degree is summa cum laude. And the student has a grade point average of 3.85 or above. The cords are just another of the personal touches that are so much a part of the graduation ceremonies at Oregon State. They were made by the employees of the OSU bookstore, who are responsible for the caps and gowns that are rented to the graduates and faculty each year. This year, they are Caroline Lee, Lisa Doan, Sandra Dorr, Brandy Osborne, and Kay Gingerich. This year, too, the members of Phi Kappa Phi, the most prestigious honor society on the campus, are wearing a white ribbon pinned to the left side of the academic gown.
The music for the ceremony today is being played by the Oregon State University Symphonic Band. Band director James Douglas has been conducting the band and playing the processional, which includes the Eagle Squadron March by Kenneth Alford, Pomp and Circumstance by Edward Elgar, and the Third Movement Folk Song Suite by Ralph Vaughan Williams. The Oregon State University bands consist of several large performing organizations and smaller ensembles. All undergraduate and graduate students are enrolled in the university or eligible for membership. They may receive credit in the College of Liberal Arts towards graduation. This symphonic band is one of the more exciting musical groups that is in existence at Oregon State University. The members are selected by audition, and it therefore consists of over 80 of the most skilled and advanced players on the campus. The band plays formal concerts and various performances at music festivals and conventions. When the attention is sounded, you will hear cornets being played by Greg Duell, a junior in music education from Anchorage, Alaska. Jay Chun, who is completing a master's degree in music. He is from Chengdu, China. And Chris Fisher, a graduate student in the Master of Arts in Teaching program. She's a Corvallis resident. And later, we will hear the soloist singing the national anthem. And also during the awarding of the degrees, he will be Tim Brenner, a professor in music education.
Each of the graduates who are participating in this commencement received 4 tickets for family and friends to attend the ceremony here in Gill Coliseum. To accommodate the expected overflow, Austin Auditorium in the LaSalle Stewart Center, just across the street from the Coliseum, has been opened. That facility will seat about 1,000 persons to watch this telecast. A new large television projection system has recently been installed with funds from the user fees of the previous system. That screen is 12 by 20 feet and can provide nearly life-size images of the ceremony. We welcome all of you there in the LaSalle Stewart Center to this live broadcast.
During this ceremony, 2 Distinguished Service Awards and an honorary degree will be bestowed. The recipients will be Philip Lane Sr., a Native American and Oregon State University alumnus in the class of 1941. Mr. Lane has worked in recruiting and counseling American Indian students at Oregon State University. But he is also being honored for his professional contributions to civil engineering during his career with the U.S. Corps of Engineers. Another is Faye Stewart, a 1938 graduate of the Oregon State University College of Forestry, who is co-founder of Bohemia Incorporated. That is the pioneer in laminated beam technology and composite products. Mr. Stewart also pioneered the development of heavy lift balloons for logging sensitive sites, which has helped minimize environmental impact. The honorary degree candidate is Philip Habib, best known for his efforts to negotiate peace treaties in Vietnam and the Middle East. Bestowing these degrees and honors has been a tradition at Oregon State University since 1923.
The staff of the Registrar's Office make it possible for each candidate to receive his or her own diploma. One year, 1970, a simpler system was tried as an experiment. At the ceremony, each student was given a diploma case with a note congratulating the student and indicating that the diploma would arrive by mail in a few days. Many people didn't like the experiment and they let the president know about it. Among those in favor of the individual diploma is the staff of the Registrar's Office, which is responsible for keeping all the certificates in order. They rather liked the idea. The real question was how to have the diplomas ready on time. Until 1989, the graduation ceremony was on Sunday before final examinations. This meant excusing seniors from taking final examinations, at least during the designated examination week. Some of the faculty said it disrupted the academic process to submit grades for seniors early. The students and the alumni didn't agree. Much of this discussion ended when the ceremony date was changed to follow examination week. Under the watchful eye of Associate Registrar Russell Dix, the ceremony is proceeding according to tradition, with each student receiving his or her own diploma. It's a tradition which dates back to the first class in 1870, class of three graduates, two men and one woman.
Dr. Brian Dodd is the man in the colorful academic gown. He describes it as claret and yellow. The hat is round rather than a mortarboard. Dr. Dodd says this gown is typical of doctoral robes from the University of London. It is worn by those who are members of convocation, which Dr. Dodd describes as an advisory and legislative body of the University of London. He says it fulfills some of the functions of an alumni association in the United States. Dr. Dodd is Assistant Chief Marshal for the commencement ceremony. He is also a professor of nuclear engineering and radiation health physics for Oregon State University. Each year, by tradition, the color guard is rotated among four military units on the campus. The guard today at today's ceremony is provided by the United States Navy Reserve Officer Training Corps. Attention has been sounded. The colors are being brought into Gill Coliseum by the color guard, as we said, representatives from the United States Navy Reserve Officer Training Program. The members of this color guard are Cadet Colonel Tom Willard. Professor Tom Brimmer, a member of the faculty of the Music Education Department at Oregon State University. The color guard, made up of Cadet Colonel Tom Willard, commander of this color guard, and a sophomore in construction engineering management from Salem. Cadet Colonel Philip Bell, a sophomore in mechanical engineering from Eugene. Cadet Major Don Ray, a sophomore in mathematics from Ontario. And Cadet Second Lieutenant Mike Walker, a sophomore in geography from Tigard.
Good afternoon. My name is Todd Mickey, and I'm the 1991-92 ASOSU president. I'd like to welcome you today to the 123rd annual commencement ceremony here at Oregon State University. The men and women that stand before you today have been waiting for this moment for a very long time. They've spent hours of studying, researching, and practicing what it is that they have always dreamt of being. Today is a very special day for us, obviously, but it's not just because we're graduating. It's because you, our family and friends, are here to celebrate this great occasion with us. So once again, I'd like to welcome you to Oregon State University's 123rd annual commencement ceremonies. Have a great day. Have you all found your parents and friends up there? Members of the class of 1992. Faculty, relatives, friends, ladies, gentlemen, I too welcome you to the 123rd commencement exercise of Oregon State University. The academic commencement is clearly a time of joy and celebration, but it's also a time of reflection. It's a time to think about what you have done and what those who have supported you have done. It's a time to reflect on the fact that you are part of a tradition which goes back many centuries as we celebrate the completion of one phase of life and perhaps the beginning of another. At Oregon State University, we regard commencement to be a family affair. And there are a lot of people who have given you lots of support during this particular period of your life, and we'd like to recognize them at this point. So would all of the parents, the fathers and the mothers of the graduates, please stand up so we can recognize you. There's another group of people who feel very close to you, too, as you graduate. And those are the spouses and the children of any of the graduates. Would you stand up so we can recognize you as well? And if this commencement is like any other that we've had here, we know there are some grandparents here too. And so, grandparents, please stand up. And just on the chance that there might be some, are there any great grandparents here that would like to be? There we go. Brothers and sisters, and I might say other members of the family, but I'd rather say aunts, uncles, cousins, nephews, and nieces. And we've discovered over the years that at about at this point, there are a group of people here who feel left out because they didn't get a chance to stand up. And these are the friends and anyone else. So please, everybody. There are a number of people here who have made this very special ceremony take place, made it possible for it to take place. Hopefully, if everything works right, you each will receive your own individual diploma. And I suspect there are not too many institutions in the United States, at least of this size, that continue to follow that tradition. And so we owe special thanks today to Russ Dix, the Associate Registrar. Russ, where are you? Russ is the chair of the commencement committee, who's responsible for planning this particular commencement ceremony. And he and Registrar Barbara Balls,
And their very, very competent staff have made it possible for you to each hopefully receive your own diploma. There's a group of people down here to my left that you probably won't see who are going to play a key role, and this is the staff of the registrar's office in making sure that each one of you gets that diploma. So if you have time during the occasion, you might just look over there because they do a magnificent job. Now, on the platform in front of you, there are a number of people who will play a role in this particular ceremony this afternoon, but there are also some who will not. But they're here because they play a very important role in the operation of Oregon State University, and I'd like to introduce them at this time. Dr. Larry Small. Larry is the Associate Dean of the College of Oceanography. Dr. Stanley Snyder, who is here representing the College of Veterinary Medicine. The Doctorate of Veterinary Medicine was conferred at a separate ceremony on Sunday, May 24th, and I might interject at this point that we sincerely hope that that ceremony will continue for many, many years into the future. Representing the Marine Corps ROTC, Lieutenant Colonel Barney Grimes. And for Naval Science, Captain Robert Curtis. Representing Military Science, Major Ben Girding. Representing Aerospace Studies, Colonel Jim Swinyard. And I'm going to ask Bob Curtis and Jim Swinyard to stand up once more because this will be their last commencement at Oregon State. I already introduced Barbara Balls and Russ Dix. Somewhere in the group is Ralph Riley. Ralph, assistant registrar, and he really focuses on that group off to the left of the stage. And then also Vice President Coate, Ed Coate, Vice President for Finance and Administration. And I think everybody else will play a role this afternoon, and you will see them later. We have a long tradition at Oregon State. It's a tradition that we have done our utmost to uphold over the years, and that's the tradition of excellence. Excellence in everything we do. We don't always achieve it, but hopefully we always strive for it. And there is a group of people among you that really represents the core of that excellence. This is the faculty of Oregon State University. The faculty are the university. And so would each faculty member in this assembly please stand and be recognized. There are a number of things in your program that I'd like to direct your attention to. You will have ample time during the afternoon to look through the program. There are special honors and awards, and these are listed on page 74. And I hope that you will take the time to look at those. There are also listings of fellowships and scholarships, as well as a statement of appreciation of the many gifts received by the university. These are listed on page 79. And I do hope that you'll take time to look at that. And during the afternoon, I hope that you will reflect. Reflect for a while on the importance of the education you have received. It's not complete, but it's a good start. You had a fine education at Oregon State University. And that education is not just to obtain a job when you graduate, but to enable you to be better citizens as your life evolves and matures, and to make a greater contribution to society. I think it's a time for all of us to reflect on the importance of that education, not only to you as individuals, but to our society, our community, our state, our nation, And I hope that during the afternoon you will think about that somewhat. It's been a long tradition at Oregon State to receive greetings from a member of the Board of Higher Education. And at this time, I'd like you to join me, not yet, in a moment, in welcoming the representative from the Board of Higher Education today, Mr. Mark S. Dodson. Mark Dodson was appointed to the board in January of 1987 and reappointed in 1989. He has been past president of the board and is currently the vice chairman of the board's Committee on Academic Affairs. He serves on the board's Administrative Review Committee. He is an attorney in Portland. He's a partner in the firm of Atter, Wynn, Hewitt, Dodson, and Skerritt. During his career, he has been special counsel to the United States Department of Transportation and to the Federal Aviation Administration during the Carter administration. He's a graduate of Harvard University. He holds the JD from Bolt Law School, University of California at Berkeley. And he is here to share greetings from the Board of Higher Education. Mark Dodson.
Officiating at graduation is the most joyous assignment you can draw as a board member, but I have to tell you that along with all of the other members who were standing just a little while ago, I have known some of the members of the class of 92 for most, if not all, of their life, so I share that particular joy with you today. To President Byrne, I want to say that the positive attitude on this campus is an inspiration to the entire system. But I want to take just an extra special moment to thank the faculty here at Oregon State for the innovative way in which they've responded to the need for research, scholarship, and teaching. In the almost 6 years that I've been on the Board of Higher Education, I can say unequivocally that this campus, the faculty on this campus, have treated the entire state as their campus. And the degree of professionalism and the concept of service that you find here is truly remarkable. To all those who are standing, to the parents, spouses, family members, I want to thank you for all the encouragement, support. The entire state owes you a debt of gratitude. And now finally to the class of 1992. I just want to say that you've done the best job you can of preparing yourself. Whether you go on with your formal education or you immediately enter the workplace at this point, you're prepared for a lifetime of learning. A friend of mine is fond of quoting William Shakespeare as saying that it's not always ours to command success, but we can do more. We can deserve it. You deserve our thanks and our congratulations today. I want to wish you best wishes and good luck for tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mark. At this point, Provost and Vice President for Academic Affairs, Roy Arnold, will recognize retiring and emeritus faculty. Roy?
We are indeed pleased to honor today several faculty members who have recently, after many years of service at OSU, chosen to retire. We are proud to recognize their many accomplishments and to welcome them to the community of emeritus faculty. Their names and their disciplinary affiliations are listed on page 5 of your commencement program. A number of these individuals are here with us today, and I ask that they rise so that we might recognize them and express our appreciation to them at this time. Please rise. We wish the very best to each of these outstanding faculty members. Thank you.
These ceremonies, for many of us, seem to be the same each year, but we notice that every year there is a slightly new wrinkle, a slightly new thing to be proud of, a recognition of certain achievement. And for the first time, this class, the class of 1992, Some of you may be awarded the special recognition of being graduated with academic distinction. Baccalaureate degree candidates who have maintained the highest scholastic standing in their respective colleges for at least 2 academic years qualify for this designation. This year, 384 seniors are graduating with academic distinction. To be eligible for summa cum laude, a student must have maintained a grade point average of at least 3.85. To be eligible for magna cum laude, a student must have maintained a grade point average of between 3.70 and 3.84. And to be eligible for cum laude, a student must have maintained a grade point average of between 3.50 and 3.69. All of these students are wearing an honor cord, which indicates the level of their academic achievement. Their names appear on page 40 of the commencement program, and the names of the seniors who have completed university honors program are listed on page 43. Will all of the students who qualify for graduation with academic distinction please stand at this point? Listed on page 73, again of your commencement program, are the names of 46 other graduating students who receive special distinction. These are students who receive commissions in the United States Armed Services as separate commissioning ceremonies in the past few days. Oregon State University is one of less than 35 universities with all 4 services represented. We'd like to acknowledge those students who received commissions in the United States services during the past several days. Would those officers please stand? Now, Dr. Joanne Tro, Vice President for Student Affairs, will describe your class to you.
There are many ways to describe the class of 1992. I'm going to give you some numbers today. Oregon State University's class of 1992, the university's 123rd class, consists of 3,967 persons who will be receiving 4,051 degrees. Of this number, 2,296 of you are men, 1,755 are women. 3,055 will be receiving the baccalaureate degree, 765 will be awarded the master's degree, 32 have been awarded the Doctor of Veterinary Medicine degree at a ceremony earlier, and 199 will be awarded the degree of Doctor of Philosophy or Doctor of Education. There are 79 of you, however, who will receive 2 degrees today. One will receive 3 degrees, and one will receive 4 degrees. Geographically, most of you are from the state of Oregon. All of Oregon's 36 counties are represented. But this is also an institution of national and international significance. Of the 50 United States, this year's class lists 45 plus 2 trust territories as their home. Internationally, 64 countries are represented. The average age of the class is 25. The oldest member is 63, while the youngest is but 20. In attendance at today's ceremony are 2,005 candidates. You will be joining 136,000 other proud OSU degree holders. We welcome you to the ranks of alumni of the university, our best wishes to you for the future, and our congratulations.
Some of our students completed the requirements for graduation at the close of the summer or the fall or the winter terms, but it's been our practice to confer degrees only at this June commencement. Some who finished earlier in the year are located far away and couldn't be with us, and so their degrees will be conferred in absentia. The academic nature of an institution is dependent on its faculty, and so it really is the faculty who present to you the degree. Representing the Faculty Senate is Dr. Kathleen Heath, and she will convey the formal approval of the Faculty Senate for the graduating class of 1992.
President Byrne, on behalf of the Faculty Senate and the faculty of Oregon State University, I commend to you for the conferring of their respective degrees all of those who have completed the appropriate graduation requirements.
Thank you very much. We are now ready to start conferring degrees. And first, we confer the doctorates. Dr. Tom Marsh, Dean of the Graduate School, will present the candidates for the doctor's degrees. Those receiving the doctorate are listed in the program beginning on page 6.
President Byrne, I am pleased to present 197 candidates. President Byrne, I am pleased to present 197 candidates for the doctoral degree. Of these, 192 have completed all requirements for the Doctor of Philosophy and 5 for the Doctor of Education. I commend them to you for the conferral of their respective degrees.
Thank you, Dean Marsh. Upon the recommendation of the Graduate Council, approved by the Faculty Senate, and by the authority of the State Board of Higher Education, I confer upon each of you the degree of Doctor of Philosophy or Doctor of Education, according to the particular requirements completed, with all the responsibilities, privileges, and honors thereunto appertaining. In witness whereof, you will be presented with your diploma, and you will each be vested with the appropriate academic hood.
Roger Allen Frank.
Tom, you might say that there'd be a cut.
Each of the doctoral students is accompanied by a major professor. Marianne Sue Clousing Lee. Dorrance Joseph Cote. Clyde A. Rasmussen. Susan E. Adams. Salah H. Alswamy. M. Aslam Ali. Luana Joa Beeson. Barbara Boyd Boltos. Louis Douglas Bombardier. Stephen Richard Booth. Kirk Ray Brown. Giuseppe Serban. Jiyun Hung Chen. Gui Wen Cheng. Mary Marshall Klusky. Jinwoo Yeo. Margaret Wynn Fox. Christopher Andrew Frizzell. David Harrison Gonzalez. Deborah Lee Good. Kenneth Ray Green. Bruce Jeffrey Grohl. Mark Alson Gumman. Carl Richard Hagelberg.
Slow down.
Day H. Halling.
This is Hagelberg.
Day H. Halling. Waymin Han. Diane Kettner Hart. Abel Hernandez Guerrero. Britton Eames Hill. Yang Pio Hong. Kamal Islam. Jidong Jiang. Wayne Edward Johnson. Bohumil Casal. Jack Danwood Kelly Abarca. Gary Michael Kilberg. Sungbae Kim. Lynn Diane Krasnell. Viwat Krishnasimha. Wilhelmina Kwanzaa. Suncheng Kwan. LaJean Lawson. Martha Eugenia Lee. Stephen Peter Lee. Kaiming Lei.
This should be Nyan Ku Lee.
Nyan Ku Lee. Nyan Ku Lee.
We don't have Nyan Ku Lee.
Okay, Myon Ku Lee.
Steve Lee.
Stephen Peter Lee. Kai Ming Lei. Stephen Peter Lee. Okay, Kai Ming Lei. Zuyang Liang. Susan Carol McNaught. Robert James Miller. Mehran Fala Mohadam. Julie Gass Newsom. Oscar Stephen Norbert. Nancy Chun Oppie. John Pankratz. Dale Paul Parnell Jr. Heidi Ann Petit. Guosheng Peng. Glyceria Estandian Pimentel. Beverly Ann Huistad. M. Jolene Ramaker. Udaya Ananda Ranawaki. Abbas M. Shirazi. Philip Epps Schuler. Edward Jude Mamadou Salou Smith. Monty K. Smith. Walter Blair Summers. Carmen Dobson Stagel. Carl Wayne Stevenson. Pamela Jean Smith Teschner. Paul Douglas Thompson. Gregory David Weems. Candace Deal Wiggum. Sandra Sue Witte. Yushu Zhu. Chun Tian Ye. Dorothy Jean Yoakum. Barbara J. Yoder. James Patrick Young. Ki Zhang. Lingxu Zhang. Gongguan Zhou.
Dr. Marsh will now present the candidates for the master's degree, and these are listed beginning on page 23.
President Byrne, It is my pleasure to present 760 candidates for master degrees. This is the largest class of master students in OSU's history. Of these, three have completed all requirements for the Master of Arts degree, 49 for the Master of Arts in Interdisciplinary Studies, 406 for the Master of Science, 8 for the Master of Agriculture, 97 for the Master of Business Administration, 118 for the Master of Education, 71 for the Master of Arts in Teaching, 7 for the Master of Forestry, and 1 for the Master of Ocean Engineering. I commend them to you for the conferral of their respective degrees.
Thank you. Upon the recommendation of the Graduate Council, approved by the Faculty Senate and by the authority of the State Board of Higher Education, I confer upon each of you, according to your particular curriculum, the degree of Master of Arts, Master of Arts in Interdisciplinary Studies, Master of Agriculture, Master of Business Administration, Master of Arts in Teaching, Master of Education, Master of Forestry, Master of Ocean Engineering, or Master of Science, with all of the responsibilities, privileges, and honors thereunto appertaining. In witness whereof, you will be presented with your diploma, and you will be vested with the appropriate academic hood. I might just mention that this is the first year Oregon State University has presented the Master of Arts in Teaching degree.
Advanced degrees at Oregon State University are conferred by the graduate school. It offers the Doctor of Education and Doctor of Philosophy degrees, as Dr. Marsh has said. Oregon State also offers specialized training in professional curricula in the College of Agricultural Sciences, Business, Engineering, Forestry, Health and Human Performance, Home Economics, and Pharmacy. And in the School of Education, professional degrees can be awarded to this class of 1992. The Dean of the Graduate School is Dr. Thomas Marsh. He served Oregon State University as Chairman of the Department of Geography before assuming his duties as the Coordinator of the Graduate Education Programs. Dr. Marsh received his doctorate from the University of Illinois. His research has been in economic geography, including work on industrial location and mineral resources.
There are two graduate degree only colleges at Oregon State University. One is the College of Veterinary Medicine. It was established in 1975 to help assure an adequate supply of veterinarians to serve Oregon's and the Northwest's multi-million dollar cattle and poultry industries. 28 of the 36 possible openings each year are reserved for Oregon students. This is the 10th class. The 32 new doctors of veterinary medicine had their own special ceremony on May 24th in the LaSalle Stewart Center. Dr. Susan C. Loomis, president of the Oregon Veterinary Medical Association, administered the oath to the students. The speaker this year was Dr. Robert F. Kars, Dean of the College of Veterinary Medicine at the University of Missouri. Lauren Kohler is the Dean of the College of Veterinary Medicine here at OSU. Dr. Kohler has a degree in veterinary medicine from Washington State University and master's and doctoral degrees from the University of Wisconsin in veterinary science and pathology. Dr. Kohler was an associate professor at OSU from 1972 to 1978. Then he returned to head the college in 1986.
at the organ again this year, we hear Susan Wilburn. She's a Corvallis resident and teacher of piano and organ. She is the director of music, the organist and choir director for the First Presbyterian Church in Corvallis. This is Ms. Wilburn's 14th participation in the Oregon State University commencement. She has a master's degree in music from Westminster Choir College in Princeton, New Jersey. And a word about the organ, it is a Wurlitzer Theater pipe organ. It was a gift to Oregon State University in 1961 from the Whiteside family. When progress in the movie industry dictated a new widescreen for the Whiteside Theater, the organ became a victim of circumstances. There just wasn't enough room for both. But the organ did find a new and welcome home here in Gill Coliseum. The second college at Oregon State University, which offers graduate degrees only, is the College of Oceanography. It was only a department with one specialist in 1959. Dr. Douglas Caldwell is the dean. He has been on the Oregon State University faculty since 1968 in teaching and research. Dr. Caldwell's professional degrees are in physics from the University of Chicago. He also has a bachelor's degree in liberal arts. The college was chosen by NASA to participate in the Earth Observing System. This is the largest science mission ever undertaken in human history. Dr. Caldwell describes the 15-year program as a comprehensive global observing system that is designed to provide the first simultaneous measurements of the interactions of the atmosphere, the ocean, and terrestrial systems. Oregon State University is one of 29 institutions in the United States and abroad which will carry out this high-priority research. The United States, European, and Japanese space platforms will collect massive amounts of data for the analysis.
Each year at this time, we recognize people who have made special contribution to society. Distinguished Service Awards are granted to people who have made a contribution to society and who have rendered unusual service to Oregon State University. This year, it's a distinct privilege to recognize and honor two persons who are worthy of special recognition by Oregon State. First of these, Faye Stewart. And that name should ring a bell with some of you. The Stewart Center is named for his parent. Faye Stewart is unable to be with us today, unfortunately, but he will formally receive the Distinguished Service Award sometime during the coming fall quarter. Faye Stewart is a 1938 graduate of Oregon State's College of Forestry and is president of both the Flying Scotsman and Western Coating Companies. Page 38 of the commencement program contains a more complete citation of his impressive accomplishments. Second person is with us. And I ask at this time that Dean Fred Horn, Dean of the College of Science, and Dean George Brown, Dean of the College of Forestry, escort Philip Lane to the podium for the presentation of the Distinguished Service Award. Philip Lane, Sr., a Native American born on the Standing Rock Sioux Reservation in South Dakota, attended the Haskell Indian Institute and earned his Bachelor of Science degree in forestry from Oregon State University in 1941. Mr. Lane has devoted much of his life to the service of American Indians in the Pacific Northwest. He spent 30 years working for the Army Corps of Engineers, and during that time designed a special device for pumping water to empty locks at dams so that with greater efficiency, and this helped to create a special fish ladder to prevent fish from being killed during constructions of dams. He retired from the Corps of Engineers in 1971. He has been a leading proponent for Native American rights in the Pacific Northwest. He is the spiritual leader of the National American Indian Science and Engineering Society and is the recipient of that organization's Parker Award, which he received in 1987. He's also organizer and sponsor of the Confederated Indian Tribes at the Washington State Penitentiary, a service organization dedicated to giving prisoners renewed pride and hope for a productive life. This spring, Mr. Lane was presented with Oregon State University Alumni Association's E.B. Lemon Distinguished Service Award for his accomplishments. Upon the recommendation of the Faculty Senate, it gives me great pleasure to present to Phil Lane the Oregon State University Distinguished Service Award. Several years ago, on this occasion, we reintroduced a tradition that had existed at Oregon State many years in the past, and this was the awarding of the honorary doctorate. This year, it was to have been our privilege to recognize and honor Philip Habib. Mr. Habib, who was to have been with us today to accept the honorary degree, unfortunately died very suddenly on May 25th. Nevertheless, because of his accomplishments and achievements on behalf of all of us, we wish to posthumously acknowledge his many accomplishments. Dr. George Keller, Vice President for Research, Graduate Studies, and International Programs, will read the citation that would have been read in the presence of Mr. Habib.
We deeply regret the recent passing of Dr. Philip Habib and extend our sympathy to his family. Dr. Habib has been regarded as one of the most distinguished and versatile foreign affairs officers in U.S. history. He played major roles during the Vietnam War and conflicts in the Middle East. He was a forestry major at the University of Idaho and received his bachelor's degree there, and a few years later, his PhD from the University of California, Berkeley. After launching his foreign service career in 1958 with tours in Canada, New Zealand, Trinidad, and South Korea, Dr. Habib was sent to Saigon in the mid-60s after the Vietnam War escalated. He was chosen to head a task force to study the Vietnam situation, and it was his input that led President Johnson to reduce the amount of bombing in northern Vietnam. Later that year, Dr. Habib participated in the peace talks involving the United States, North Vietnam, South Vietnam, and the Viet Cong. He went on to serve as ambassador to the Republic of Korea and Assistant Secretary of State for Asia and Pacific Affairs. In 1976, appointed by President Ford as Undersecretary of State for Political Affairs, and turned his attention to the turmoil in the Middle East. Under President Carter, Dr. Habib played a major role in the Camp David peace accords, helping to arrange a historic meeting between Egyptian President Anwar Sadat and Israeli Prime Minister Menachem Begin. Among his many awards, with the decoration as Commander of the French Legion of Honor, the Rockefeller Public Service Award, the President's Medal for Distinguished Federal Service, and the President's Medal of Freedom. President Byrne, I am pleased to recommend Dr. Philip Charles Habib for the degree of Doctor Humane Letters.
On the recommendation of the Faculty Committee on Honorary Doctorates and the Provost, and by the authority of the State Board of Higher Education, I posthumously confer upon Philip Habib the degree of Doctor of Humane Letters from Oregon State University. Okay, now's the time. For most of you, anyway, this is the moment. We will now confer bachelor's degrees in the order listed in the commencement program. And if you haven't already found your name, start on page 44. Associate Dean of the College of Liberal Arts will now present candidates for the degrees from her college, Associate Dean Sally Malig.
President Byrne, on behalf of the faculty of the College of Liberal Arts, I present the graduates from the programs in the Fine Arts, Humanities, and Social Sciences, the heart of a university education. There are 25 students graduating with a Bachelor of Fine Arts degree, 254 graduating with a Bachelor of Arts degree, and 704 graduating with a Bachelor of Science degree. The 1992 graduating class consists of 483 men and 500 women. And I want also to make special mention of the graduates in broadcast media communication, journalism, and religious studies whose majors are officially being discontinued after this year. It is an honor for me to present the 983 College of Liberal Arts students to you.
Thank you. Dean Horn will now present the candidates for the baccalaureate degree from the College of Science. All of the College of Science. Yeah, that's fine. Thank you.
President Byrne, I'm honored and pleased to present to you the 339 candidates for the degrees of Bachelor of Science and Bachelor of Arts in the College of Science. Of these 333 received the degree of Bachelor of Science, 6 the degree of Bachelor of Arts. Of the total, 178 men, 161 women. Congratulations.
Thank you, Dean Horn. Dean Weiser will now present the candidates for the baccalaureate from the College of Agricultural Sciences.
President Byrne, it's a pleasure to present the 209 Bachelor of Science degree candidates from the College of Agricultural Sciences, 15 of whom are from the OSU programs at Eastern Oregon State College, 61 women and 148 men.
Thank you very much, Dean Weiser. Dean Parker will now present the candidates from the College of Business.
Mr. President, on behalf of the faculty of the College of Business, I am pleased to present to you 306 men and 175 women candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree, and 42 women and 20 men candidates for the Bachelor of Arts degree. I and the faculty of the college take great pleasure in recommending that their degrees be conferred.
Thank you. Dean Haverson will now present the candidates from the College of Education.
President Byrne, it is my pleasure to present to you the final graduating class from the College of Education, 15, one candidate for the Bachelor of Science and 14, or I'm sorry, one candidate for the Bachelor of Science and 14 candidates for the Bachelor of Arts. Thank you.
Thank you. Dean Owen will now present the candidates from the College of Engineering.
President Byrne, Mr. Dodson, on behalf of the faculty of the College of Engineering, I would like to present to you the extremely well-qualified young men and women for their bachelor's degrees in engineering. We're graduating 449, we're awarding 449 degrees, of which 384 of those go to men and 62 go to women.
Thank you, Dean Owen. Dean Brown will present the candidates from the College of Forestry.
President Byrne, on behalf of the faculty of the College of Forestry, I'm pleased to present 79 candidates for the Bachelor of Science degree in Forestry, all anxious to take their place in the management of our nation's forests and forest industries, and to join the ranks of such distinguished foresters as Philip Habib, Phil Lane, and Faye Stewart. I recommend them to you for conferral of the degree.
Thank you, Dean Brown. Dean Maxed will now present the candidates from the College of Health and Human Performance.
President Byrne, it's both my privilege and pleasure to present the 1992 graduating class from the College of Health and Human Performance. This year's class includes 133 men and women who have completed all of the degree requirements. On behalf of the faculty of the college, it is my pleasure to commend them to you for their degree.
Thank you. Associate Dean Helmick will now present the candidates from the College of Home Economics.
President Byrne, with great pride, I present to you the 215 graduates of the College of Home Economics, 20 fine young men, and 95 equally fine women graduates.
Thank you. Dean Oval will now present the candidates from the College of Pharmacy.
President Byrne, on behalf of the faculty of the College of Pharmacy, I am proud to present to you the pharmacy class of 1992, an extraordinary group of 57 women and 29 men who have completed the requirements for the Bachelor of Science degree in pharmacy, and I recommend them to you for that degree.
Dean Oval, how did we let them get up here in front? We used to keep them way in the back. I shall now confer your degree. Will you please all rise? Now, I have to put in a caveat here. Official grades for spring term will be turned in tomorrow. The following conferral statement is subject to confirmation of the final status of some degree candidates. Nevertheless, Upon recommendation of the Committee on Academic Requirements, as approved by the Faculty Senate and by the authority of the State Board of Higher Education, I confer upon each of you who meets all requirements, according to your particular curriculum, the degree of Bachelor of Arts, Bachelor of Fine Arts, Bachelor of Science, with all the privileges, honors, as well as responsibilities thereunto appertaining. Students will receive their diplomas in alphabetical order by college, and each student will receive his or her individual diploma, we hope, as has long been the tradition at Oregon State University. Congratulations.
Awarding the class of 1992, their diplomas are those in the class. They are escorted by faculty marshals to the ramp, and the graduates will walk up to meet the deans of their college. This is one of the unique features of the ceremony.
The first undergraduates to receive diplomas today are in the College of Pharmacy. They wear olive green tassels. The college was formed in 1917 with Adolf Ziefle as the first dean. Dr. Richard Oval is the present dean. He came to OSU in 1976. He had served as a community pharmacist and as a consultant to two pharmaceutical companies. Dean Oval has done considerable research and writing in pharmacy administration and practice, and also on the status of women in the profession. The curriculum for the College of Pharmacy consists of 2 years of pre-pharmacy courses taken during the freshman and sophomore years, followed by 3 years of professional pharmacy courses. Thus, a total of 5 years is required to complete formal pharmacy education. Major options include pharmaceutical chemistry, pharmaceutical science, and pharmacology and toxicology. A student may concentrate in such areas as general pharmacy practice, clinical pharmacy, administrative pharmacy, or industrial pharmacy, or the student may prepare for graduate study.
Russet is the color of the tassels worn by the graduates in the College of Forestry. Their college was formed in 1913. George Peavy was the first dean. Dr. George Brown is the present dean. He replaced Dr. Carl Stoltenberg, who retired after a commencement in 1989 and after 22 years as dean. Dean Brown has been an Oregon State University administrator and faculty member for 23 years. He has served as Associate Dean for Research in the College of Forestry and also as head of the Department of Forest Engineering. Foresters help in developing and maintaining forest and recreational values, in harvesting forest crops, in wood product development, processing and marketing, in teaching and in research. The college offers major undergraduate curricula in forest engineering, in forest management, forest products, and resource recreation management. A forest engineering option in civil engineering, forest engineering, is offered jointly with the College of Engineering. And the college also offers a graduate degree in forest science.
Maize is the color of the tassels worn by the degree candidates in the College of Agricultural Sciences. Actually, work in the field of agriculture has been provided for undergraduate students since 1868, but the college was officially formed in 1908. A.B. Cordley was the first dean. This is the first commencement for Dean Conrad J. Weiser. He replaced Dr. Roy Arnold when he was named vice president and provost for OSU last fall. Dr. Weiser had been head of the horticulture department for 18 years and was the first OSU scientist to be named to the Board on Agriculture of the National Academy of Science. Dean Weiser earned his bachelor's degree at North Dakota State University and his PhD at OSU, then began his teaching and research career at the University of Minnesota Horticulture Department. On the northwest corner of the main OSU campus is a new 180,000 square foot structure which is named Agricultural Sciences II. It's the center for research and teaching in agricultural and life sciences. The scientists who occupy Agricultural Sciences II, along with the students they train, are working primarily in plant systems, molecular and cellular biology and biotechnology, environmental toxicology, and ecosystems biology. These are all areas of outstanding strength at Oregon State University. Specifically, the building will house the Center for Gene Research and Biotechnology and the Environmental Health Sciences Center, along with the departments of biochemistry and biophysics, agricultural chemistry, horticulture, and the soil science section of crop and soil science. And it also contains instructional laboratories where students learn from their own participation in research projects. The College of Agricultural Science is organized into four major divisions: academic programs, agricultural experiment station, the extension service, and international agriculture. There are 14 academic departments with about 1,200 undergraduate and graduate students, 10 branch agricultural experiment stations doing research around the state, extension service offices in every county, and one of the country's largest international agricultural development programs.
Graduates in the College of Home Economics wear maroon tassels. It has been more than a century since the Chair of Household Economy and Hygiene was established on the Oregon Agricultural College campus in 1888. Dr. Margaret Snell, a physician, was named the first professor. She served as head of the department until a formal school was formed in 1908. The present dean is Kinsey B. Green, who came to the campus in 1984. Dr. Green had been an executive director of the American Home Economics Association, a faculty member at the University of Maryland, and taught high school home economics in Virginia. Because Dr. Green is away, Associate Dean Sandra Helmick is handing out diplomas today. Dr. Helmick came to Oregon State last year from the University of Missouri, where she was a professor of family economics and associate dean in the home economics program. She serves Oregon State University as director of the new Family Studies Center at Oregon State. The past year has been exciting for the faculty in the College of Home Economics. They have formed a new partnership with colleagues from the College of Education who will receive their degrees in the section just following home economics. On July 1st, the two units will be merged into one college. The college is also seeking a new scholar to hold the Barbara Emily Knudsen Endowed Chair in Family Policy, the only such position in the nation. The chair is named for Mrs. Knudsen, a home economics alumna of the class of 1939, who provided a general gift to support the new faculty position. And the new family policy program will be directed at promoting public policies and programs that are beneficial for families, as indicated through research conducted at the Family Study Center in areas such as caregiving for the elderly, health insurance, tax reform, and consumer protection. Dr. Green says the gift for the endowed chair and another by Mercedes Bates, both of the College of Home Economics, are the second and third largest gifts ever given by individuals to Oregon State University. The Family Study Center is the only academic building on the Oregon State campus built entirely with private funds. Two-thirds of the construction costs were contributed by alumni and other 16% by individuals who are committed to the college. Usually, such facilities at public universities are built with state and federal appropriations. The contribution from Mercedes Bates, a member of the class of 1936, provided the major funding source for the Family Study Center, which opened this year and will be formally dedicated on October the 3rd. The center is the only facility in the United States dedicated to the study of family members throughout the lifespan. Faculty and students using the center study child development, gerontology, consumer behavior, adolescent counseling methods, and family functioning. The college has the only PhD granting programs in home economics specializing in the Western region, and undergraduate students can choose to major in nutrition, dietetics, food services, and systems, interior merchandising, housing, apparel design, early childhood education, human development, communications, family studies, gerontology, or family resource management. Stepping up to the podium now are those students receiving their degrees in the College of Education from Acting Dean Wayne Haverson.
Golden yellow tassels indicate these bachelor degree candidates are in the College of Science. The college was formed in 1932. The first dean was Earl Packard, who served from 1933 until 1939. The present dean is Frederick Horn, who came to the campus in October of 1986 from Michigan State University, where he was associate dean of the College of Natural Science. Dr. Horn is a professor of chemistry. He earned his bachelor's degree at Harvard, where he was a Harvard National Scholar, and he received his PhD from the University of Kansas, where he was a National Science Foundation Fellow. Dr. Horn was also a National Science Foundation postdoctoral fellow at Stanford University for a year. The College of Science is a major academic unit at OSU. It has 14 departments which offer bachelor, master, and doctoral degrees, plus special pre-professional programs in health and medical fields. Over 3,000 students major in science. About 80% are undergraduate students, the other 20% are in the graduate school. The College of Science provides majors in biological, earth, mathematical, and physical sciences for students who desire a liberal education, career preparation, or preparation for advanced study in science. The undergraduate departmental majors literally run from A to Z, and that includes atmospheric sciences, biology, botany and plant pathology, chemistry, computer science, entomology, geography, geology, mathematics, microbiology, physics, statistics, and zoology. Special programs include general science and science and math education. Pre-professional preparation is offered in dentistry, dental hygiene, medicine, medical technology, nursing, optometry, physical therapy, podiatry, and veterinary medicine. The college also offers a certificate program in science, technology, and society.
There were but I never saw them winging. No, I never saw them at all till there was you. And there was music, and there were wonderful roses, they tell me, in sweet fragrant meadows of dawn and dew. There was love all around, but I never heard it singing. No, I never heard it at all till there was you.
Oh, oh, the Wells Fargo wagon, it's a coming down the street. Oh, please let it be for me. Yes, it's the Wells Fargo wagon that's coming down the street. I wish I knew what it could be. Lida Rose, I'm home again, Rose, to get the sun back in.
And now coming over the ramp to receive their degrees, the students in the College of Health and Human Performance, they wear sage green tassels to identify their college. This is a relatively new college at Oregon State. It was formed in 1974 as the Department of Health and Physical Education. The name was changed in 1989 to College of Health and Human Performance. The first dean was James W. Long, who served until his retirement in 1980. Since then, Dr. Michael Maxud has been the dean. He holds a PhD in physical education and physiology from Michigan State University. The college is responsible for professional study programs leading to baccalaureate degrees in health, emphasizing environmental health and safety administration. It also provides study in exercise and sports science, emphasizing pre-therapy, athletic training, commercial and industrial fitness, sports leadership, or applied exercise and sports science. In addition, the college provides instruction in health and sports science for all Oregon State University students in other colleges of the university, and professional courses in health and sports science for graduate programs. The college offers a baccalaureate degree in healthcare administration and a graduate degree in movement studies for the disabled.
What could I do, my dear, to catch your ear? I love you madly, madly, Madam Librarian. Marion, heaven help us if the library caught on fire and the volunteer hose brigade man had to whisper the news to Marion. Madam Librarian.
The degree candidates in the College of Business wear drab tassels on their mortar boards. The College of Business was formed as the first School of Commerce in 1908. The first dean was J.A. Bexell. The present dean is Dr. Donald Parker, who for 6 years was dean of the University of Wyoming College of Commerce and Industry. Dr. Parker also holds the Sarah Hart Kimball Dean's Chair at Oregon State. Dean Parker brings the experience of 23 years in the United States Navy, where from 1976 to 78, he was a professor of management at the Naval War College. Dr. Parker was also on the business faculty at the University of Michigan. He has earned degrees from the University of Oklahoma, George Washington University and Cornell University. The College of Business is now the second largest college on the campus. The popularity of programs in business administration may have been partly responsible for the growth, but Oregon State University is unique because the growth was consistent and steady. The College of Business offers major work in business administration with a concentration in general business, international business, accounting, financial management, financial services, management information systems, and marketing management. Minors to accompany each major are available in non-business areas, and there is a post-baccalaureate certificate in accounting.
To remind you that the soloist we heard singing with the symphonic band at Oregon State University with those selections from the Music Man was Tim Brimmer. He is a professor of music at here at Oregon State University. And all through this academic procession and the awarding of the degrees, we have been hearing music familiar to many, including El Capitan by John Philip Sousa, Overture to Candide by Leonard Bernstein, English Dances, the trombone solo from Marceau's Symphonique by Gilmont. It featured Mike DeRoost from Grants Pass, who receives his bachelor's degree in music today. Of course, the selections from The Music Man, another of John Philip Sousa's Stars and Stripes Forever, the second movement from Sailors and Whales by Francis Macbeth, the Overture to Orpheus by Jacques Offenbach, often called Can-Can, the Freelance March by Sousa, and Lazy River and other Dixie tunes from the Basketball Band Library. And at recessional time, the Oregon State University Symphonic Band will play the March to Freedom from Three Revolutionary Marches by Smetana. Thank you. universities are an institution that date back many, many years, and originally it was a guild of masters of arts. The degree and the was the step by which the distinction of becoming a full member of the guild was obtained. The use of academic degrees was based on the same idea as the system in which an apprentice, after serving his time, obtained a testimonial of his skills and his license to practice his trade, or as it was called, mystery. The Master of Arts was admitted by his superiors to begin, that is to teach, and from this terminology comes the word commencement for describing the ceremonies at the end of the academic year. The term bachelor was originally used to describe a man who was the assistant of a small landowner and in the medieval times denoted the apprentice as opposed to the master workman. It's uncertain when the title of doctorate was established as a degree superior to that of master, but at Bologna it was conferred in law in the 12th century, and Paris gave the degree in divinity about the same time. There is mention of the doctors of the different faculties at Oxford as early as 1184. So the term was evidently used as a title for those possessing the highest degree of learning soon after the establishment of the first universities. Seniors in the College of Engineering wear orange tassels on their mortarboards. This is another of the colleges formed in 1908. The first dean was G.A. Cobell. Dr. John Owen became dean in 1990. He also serves as Vice Chancellor for the Oregon Center for Advanced Technology Education. Dr. Owen came to Oregon State University in 1977 to fill the Tektronics Chair of Electrophysics and became head of the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering in 1978. Prior to that, he was a prominent engineer and educator in England and Europe. He received both of his degrees, bachelor and doctorate, from the University of Nottingham. Dr. Owen says the gown and the cap he is wearing today is typical of the British University gown. The undergraduates wear all black, The masters have a black gown with a hood in the color of the academic major. Dr. Owen says the color maroon indicates the University of Nottingham, where he received his PhD in engineering. At Oregon State University, the College of Engineering is one of the largest on the campus. It has 18% of all the students at the university, and the college attracts $10 million in grants annually. This is known as external money or non-state funds for all aspects of research. The college has 7 departments, the Engineering Experiment Station and several research institutes. Oregon State University students have traditionally scored among the highest in the country on national engineering exams. And even though the requirement for course credits to graduate is higher than other colleges, the engineers usually have the highest grade point average for all of the graduating classes. And in the fall, a large number of the presidential scholars coming to Oregon State University will be enrolled in the College of Engineering. The college covers a wide variety of disciplines. They start with agricultural engineering, chemical engineering, civil engineering, electrical engineering, computer engineering, industrial engineering, manufacturing engineering, mechanical engineering, nuclear engineering, and also computer science. The college also offers majors in engineering, physics, and construction engineering management. Civil engineering, forest engineering is offered jointly with the College of Forestry. Geological engineering and mining engineering are offered in cooperation with the University of Idaho. The job market for these engineers is not as good as it once was, but as Dean Owen says, there is nothing else that is as good. And in what has been called good years, 80% would have jobs by February or March, and can select from multiple offers. This year is just taking a little longer, especially if the graduate is wanting to work in a particular location. Dr. Owen says he's predicting that by fall, 90% of this engineering class of 1992 will be employed or in graduate school. He says 60% of the job offers that come through the University Placement Center are for engineers, and they have starting salaries ranging from $30,000 to $40,000, but they do go higher. Dr. Byrne introduced the 46 Oregon State University students who have completed ROTC, or Reserve Officer Training Corps, courses, along with their regular degree work. They have already been commissioned as officers in the military services in other ceremonies this weekend as part of the commencement activities on the Oregon State University campus. 17 were commissioned in the Army, 10 in the Air Force, 17 in the Navy, and 2 in the Marine Corps. Oregon State University is one of only about 30 other universities in the country that provide officer training in all 4 branches of the military. Along with their regular degree work, officer candidates take an ROTC class each term and also attend summer camp. Active duty tours for graduates range from 3 months to 6 years.
finally, we see the graduating seniors in the College of Liberal Arts wearing white tassels on their mortarboards if getting a Bachelor of Arts degree. Some will be wearing brown tassels indicating a Bachelor of Fine Arts degree. The College of Liberal Arts was formed in 1959. The first dean was Ralph Colby. He was succeeded by Dr. Gordon Gilkey and then Dr. David King. Today, Associate Dean Sarah Malig is handing out the diplomas. She's been a professor of French at Oregon State University and served as chair of the Department of Foreign Languages and Literatures. Dr. Malig is standing in for Dean Bill Wilkins, who's attending a conference on higher education in Japan and the United States. Dr. Wilkins is one of 15 deans of colleges of arts and science in the United States whose expenses are being paid by the deans of Japanese universities. The conference is at the University of Tsukuba in Tokyo. Then Dean Wilkins has been invited to Kyushu University, a partner with Oregon State University in development projects around the world. Dr. Wilkins has been on the faculty at OSU since 1961 in the economics department. He served as president of the Oregon State University Faculty Senate in 1979. Dr. Wilkins is a specialist in international transportation and resource problems. In 1975 and 1976, he was a staff economist for the Committee on Ways and Means in the U.S. House of Representatives. Dean Wilkins says you should think of the college as one of the academic centers of the university. There are 2,000 students majoring in liberal arts. There are nearly 300 faculty members teaching basically all of the things that one would think of as being in the social studies, the arts, and the humanities. The College of Liberal Arts offers a major program in liberal studies. It also offers certificate programs in human services, Latin American affairs, and women's studies. There are departmental majors in anthropology, art, economics, English, and foreign languages and literatures, particularly French, German, and Spanish. There are also majors in history, music, philosophy, political science, psychology, religious studies, sociology, and speech communications. And there's an interdepartmental major in American studies. The College of Liberal Arts has recently honored 10 students as outstanding seniors for the 1991-92 academic year. They are Josette Griffiths, Foreign Languages, Linda King, History and Political Science, and Marilyn Schaefer, English, all from Corvallis. William Henry Harry York, a history major from Grants Pass. Todd McKay in broadcast media communication, and Bethany Swick in sociology from Oregon City. Katrin Barber, American Studies and History from Portland. Zaza Palyaji, broadcast media communication from Salem. Kenneth Pearson, history and psychology major from West Lynn. And Joyce Selig, psychology from Placerville, California. The economics department has also named the first winner of what's to be an annual award to the graduating senior in economics who has the best grade point average in those courses. She is Catherine Abney of Albany. Thank you.
the story of commencements and all its traditions at Oregon State University begins with the first class in 1870. There were three students, two men and one woman, who graduated from Corvallis College. It had received its charter just 2 years earlier in 1868. At first, commencement exercises were held in the nearby City Hall. After a wing was added to the college building, the ceremonies could be conducted in the spacious college chapel, which happened to be 30 by 60 feet. The pioneer landmark of the College on the Hill was built in 1888. It was first known as the College Building, then as the Main Building. Next, it was Administration, and it is now known as Benton Hall. The first commencement there was in June 1889 in the chapel on the second floor. By 1898, another new building, known then as Armory Gym, was completed. Though it has had several designations, we know it now as Mitchell Playhouse. The class of 1889 was the first to hold its commencement in the new Armory Gym, just as with the next dozen classes. Incidentally, it was the class of 1908 that was the first to wear the academic gowns, which are today so much a part of the commencement tradition on every campus and in high schools. As the Oregon State campus continued to expand, the Armory was built in 1910. It next became the site of the annual commencement festivities. Today, that building has been renamed McAlexander Fieldhouse. The class of 1910 held its commencement exercises there, but the ceremonies returned to what had been called the Armory Gym, but was now the gymnasium. In 1911, another tradition of commencement began, the academic procession on the campus. The tradition of the academic procession forming out on the campus has continued down through the years, with very few occasions when the weather has driven it undercover. And even before the men's gym, a new building, was accepted by the administration, it was used for the commencement ceremonies of the class of 1914. In 1929, the Memorial Union was built, and at its completion and the commencement was held there the day after the building was dedicated. In 1943, it was wartime, and Oregon State held a December commencement. For this special graduation, senior men were in uniform rather than in cap and gown. Oregon State's Coliseum was completed in 1950. And this building has housed the ceremonies for the largest classes to graduate from Oregon State University. In all, Oregon State University commencements have been held in 8 sites. 1961 was the last year that a baccalaureate service was held, and 1962 marked the first Sunday afternoon commencement program. This is the 8th commencement in which Dr. John Byrne has presided. He arrived in the fall of 1984 and was officially inaugurated as president on March 10, 1985.
I think maybe it's appropriate to thank Registrar Barbara Balls and Russ Dix and Ralph Riley and that whole staff again. I think they did a tremendous job. We're getting close to the end now, but there's still a little bit more, so hang with us. It's been a tradition at Oregon State, and I don't know how long, 20 or 30 years, I guess, at this time for us to not have a commencement speech, but rather to remind you of some things that perhaps you've seen over and over again, and things that were words that were penned when they perhaps had a slightly different meaning. But the thoughts that they conveyed are still the same. On the inside cover of your program, you see something called the Oregon State Creed. And you might want to read along with it with me. I believe in Oregon State, builder of men and women, seeker after truth, organized for the service of a great commonwealth. I believe in her traditions, a heritage from the deeds and dreams of yesterday, in her sportsmanship and honor, a reality with the students of today, in her aspirations and ideals, the assurance of a magnificent tomorrow. I believe in her democracy and her far-reaching bond of Beaver brotherhood. Sisterhood, too. And I realize that since she has accepted me as a Beaver, I, too, am a guardian of the Beaver spirit. If I degrade myself, I degrade her. As I honor myself, I honor her. I therefore pledge to her, my alma mater, my loyalty, my love, and my devotion. What you have done to come to this point is important. Many of you have worked very hard under very trying circumstances. For some of you, perhaps it was a bit easier. Nevertheless, you all met the challenge. You're all here today to receive your degree and to go on to something else. As of this moment, you're no longer students of Oregon State University. You are now alumni of Oregon State University. And at this time, it gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce to you Peggy Woods, President of the Oregon State University Alumni Association, who will welcome you to your new affiliation as alumni. Peggy?
Thank you, Dr. Byrne. Congratulations, graduates, parents, faculty, and all who have helped make this day a reality. On behalf of the Oregon State University Alumni Association, I want to welcome you all as new members. During the fun times and the tough times here at OSU, you have developed many relationships that you will carry with you for life. Treasure these friendships and keep them active. In the years ahead, you will have an opportunity to become a member of many professional organizations, clubs, and other associations. But the one you are joining today is the one I hope you treasure, support, and maintain contact with for the rest of your lives. With your class, the number of OSU living graduates has grown to over 116,000. No matter where you go, in all 50 states and virtually every corner of the world, you can make contact with a fellow OSU alum. And the OSU Alumni Association will help you find and maintain these contacts. We wish you every success in what lies ahead. Go forth with pride in Oregon State University and be an enthusiastic and active member of your Alumni Association. Thank you.
We have a rule that if you make a mistake, it should not be your last decision. And so I have another decision to make, and that is to introduce somebody who we neglected the first time around, and somebody who is very, very important, particularly in the context of the situation you just experienced, that of alumni. Lynn Spruill, Vice President for University Relations. And I think just as a little footnote to that, his wife has been playing trumpet in the band this afternoon. At this point, we do have a few announcements, and then we'll all get up and sing the alma mater and leave. Following this ceremony, it's traditional we have a reception in the MU lounge, and you and your family and friends are all invited. Mrs. Byrne and I host that, and we invite all of you to come if you'd like to. You'll meet the provost, the vice president, some of the deans will all be there. It's usually a nice occasion. I've already recognized Barbara Balls and Russ Dix and that staff who made this possible, and I think most of you did get your own diplomas. There may have been a few of you that had to swap, but that's okay. I'd like to express thanks to Anita Green from the Department of Horticulture for arranging the flowers. Normally, this floor is vacant. There are no chairs on it. We need to thank the physical plant and the service crew and service master for making the arrangements of the staging of this entire event. Thank you to them. And thanks to the ushers and the marshals, particularly, for getting you up here at the right time and in the right order. And the official photographers, you'll be amazed at the photographs that you'll have. Photographers do a fantastic job. You might want to thank them, too. Whether you realize it or not here, this has all been televised. And we express our thanks to Shirley Howard, and I understand Dick Weinman is up there as well. Thank you, folks, for bringing this to all of the people throughout the state. We appreciate that. And you can get the video on that and see what she said about you as you were going through. And as it frequently happens, because I leave toward the end some of the, I think, the finest recognition, one of them, I think, has left. Susan Wilburn, the organist, usually slips out before we have a chance to thank her. But there is a group of your associates who have given extra duty to this, who've come back to help you. And I would like you to stand and recognize Jim Douglas, Tim Brenner, and the Oregon State University Band for a truly outstanding job. And as long as you're standing up, please stay that way. We are now going to sing the alma mater. It's on the inside of the first cover, although I realize that you don't need it. It's for your parents who don't know the words. And you are going to be led by your senior class president, Ty Vincent. Now, after we sing the alma mater, please remain standing until the colors have left the auditorium, and then you can be seated and the recessional will continue. Ty, it's your turn.
There's a college we hold dear. Her shady slopes and fountains oft to me appear. I love to wander on the pathway down to the trysting tree. For there again I see it bound. Old friends dear to me, carry me back to OSU, back to her vine-clad home, the smiley ever in my memory, alma mater call.
President M. Ty Vincent. The alma mater was originally written as a class song in 1918. Both the words and the music are by Homer Maris, a member of the class of 1918. The song was dedicated to Mother Kidder, Mrs. Ira Kidder, who was OSU's first professional librarian. She was the person largely responsible for the design of the first library building. It since has been remodeled and also renamed Kidder Hall.
As the graduates with their new degree, the faculty, and the presidential party depart Gila Coliseum, the 123rd commencement at Oregon State University draws to a close. And so must this 35th telecast. Again this year, the broadcast is a cooperative effort. The Communication Media Center at Oregon State University has produced this program. Transmission of the telecast has been provided by Oregon Public Broadcasting. Thank you for joining us.